All right, let's get it in. Week two, Jets and Bullshit. Here we are. We're gonna start this off proper. We're gonna do this for you, Nelly, even though you don't deserve it. We're gonna stream hot in here on Spotify for you. Get you one stream closer to like the 3 billion streams you need to pay off your IRS debt. Here you go.
Just re-release Country Grammar.
Seriously.
Remastered.
Remastered, yeah.
Hot air, hot air. So hot air. So hot air. Hot air.
Dude, I remember listening to this song at, like, on field trips at summer camp, and when the take off all your clothes part, like, all these dudes would start taking off their clothes. It was really gay.
See, that was the issue. This song got girls take off their clothes, yeah, but then it also got men take off their clothes. Like,
it's a double-edged sword. Double-edged sword, for sure. Listening, just skip the last 4 minutes of this podcast. I probably shouldn't have.
They were looking for a lot to sweat.
we promise that'll be back later. That'll be a regular fixture in the podcast. Probably the outro or whenever, really. Yo, sweet chest hair, bro. So. So I guess let's get right into it. Jets lost 23-22 in very typical Jets fashion. Lots of missed opportunities, blown chances, stupid.
Kind of glad I don't remember some of it.
Yo, when did you black out around? Like
after the podcast, that's the last thing I remember.
Oh, doing the halftime show. Yeah. So we we tried to upgrade seats. And, like, we went down the wrong fucking stairway. Like, we went down the stairway where, like, you can't get to any other sections. It just takes you down to the exits. So we...
damn.
So, yeah.
I never always go down that first floor.
Yeah. We were in, like, the 300s or whatever. And we walked down that stairway. We get down to the 100s and we're like, fuck, we gotta go back up. So then me, you, and Frank just ended up going back to, like, the section that like we were sitting in, and we still upgraded seats. We were like one of the first rows in like in our section.
Okay. So it's some of an upgrade, but not what I'm used to.
Yeah, yeah. No, no VIP access. No sweet swag or anything like that. The swag was not unlocked.
Swag was not unlocked. Damn.
Yeah, that game was pretty much the definition of Jets. A game that should have easily been won, but just too many points left on the field.
Hey, man, just shit the bed.
Fucking a few coaching decisions to go over. 11 minutes and 28 seconds remaining in the fourth quarter. Bowles opted to kick a field goal from the 2-yard line on 4th and goal instead of going for it. And then on 4th and 1 from the 6-yard line with 3:25 remaining, they also opted to kick a field goal on a 4th and 1 to make it 20-19. If they would have went for it, honestly, they should have went for it probably both of those times, especially the first time being down by more than a field goal. You have to go for it in that situation. I guarantee you, if they would have went for it both times, they would have probably converted once. Yeah, at least one of them. And then it's a whole different game. You know, Bowles did love him some short range field goals in that fourth quarter. It's disappointing, very disappointing. And Nugent missed one kick, but there was no way he was missing two kicks. And that was the dagger.
Thing is, with Todd Bowles, it seemed like the whole second half, he made no in-game adjustments to, like, on defense, especially to like, Marvin Lewis knew, like, we would rush a lot, the whole front seven, and he, like, caught on to it. So what he started doing, telling Dole to check down, and it started working. And that bit us in the ass, like...
Yeah, that's how they kicked that field goal. They just nickeled and dimed us all the way down the field, dinking and dunking. Right. Fucking... And then A.J. Green was torching Revis, and he made no adjustments there.
Right, that was another thing. Like, the first pass, like, I was like, okay, we'll take that. But I saw, like, Marcus Gilchrist just stand there, not do anything to, like, help Revis out at all. And he saw him, like, beating Revis a lot. Like, I thought, like, maybe he should switch him to the number 2 receiver and just, like, double up on A.J. Green. Because that probably...
Revis can't be playing the number 1 receiver for every team.
Well, yeah. Of course, and this was one of the situations where they should have switched that up.
Yeah.
They should, but then the question is, who do you put on their number 1 receiver?
The only person...
Burris in a safety? Or Marcus Williams in a safety?
You develop defense towards it. You don't rely on Revis to fucking cover the motherfucker.
Yeah, I mean...
Or you can rely on Revis to cover him. For the first, 20 yards? 20, 25, maybe 30 yards? Have a safety
coming. I'd say that's a stretch, the 30 yards.
It is.
I'd say, like, 15 to 20 yards, and then you have to get that help over the top. So
I can definitely agree there.
So, kind of when I knew that, kind of the point in the game where I knew that, like, that shit wasn't gonna end well was probably the not the missed extra point, although that fucking really screwed us, but that blocked field goal, the blocked 22-yard field goal.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm not gonna lie, I kinda just had this weird feeling, like, especially what pissed me off more than the blocked field goal was probably the sequence of play callings, the 3 plays before it. Just 3 straight passing plays, all empty set shotgun shit. Like, no chance in hell of even a threat of a run. It made no sense to me. And
another thing that
those play calls ba- based on our last year's offense.
There was one point that got 80 yards,
and we just managed to work.
With Bilal Powell and Matt Forte was just killing it. And as soon as we get to the red zone, they decide to pass.
Yeah, you couldn't even run on second down, like,
yeah, right?
or you couldn't even stick him back there with Fitz to, like, at least make the, you know, at least make them, you know, have to respect the run. Then maybe those passing plays would have worked better. You can't just run empty sets every play.
Let's see what Fitz, like, even Fitz was, like, throwing behind.
Like, yeah.
We knew he'd do that since last season, and shit still hasn't changed.
You know what I don't get? Obviously, Fitz's arm strength is the one big issue with him. The reason why he's like mediocre at best. But it's like we hear about him like throwing 65-yard bombs to Eric Decker in practice. He couldn't throw the ball further than 10 yards in that game. He was 4 of 10 on passes for more than 10 yards. Like 10 yards from the line of the scrimmage. Yeah.
And they didn't even try to, like, really get Brandon Marshall back into the game. And to me, it looked like he started to get frustrated, and that's when he starts fucking up.
Oh, yeah.
That. He's done it last year. It's, like, the same thing as the game.
Marshall's a big moody player.
He gets too emotional.
Seriously.
He's Keyshawn Johnson reincarnated.
Yes.
Which
might be a little worse.
that's a stretch.
Yeah.
He might be a little better, but he also might be a little worse.
Worse in a moody sense, better in the football.
Oh, congrats on
wide receiver.
Quincy Anunua scoring his first touchdown.
No one beats Jeremy Shockey though. Kurt, throw me the ball, you faggot. And Justin is frozen once again. Oh,
there we go, I'm back.
Hey.
And he's back again. But we should talk about what we actually did do good on. The whole front seven beasted. Looked incredible.
Seven sacks.
If I tell you before this game even started, let's say like I knew the future or some shit. I say the Jets got 7 sacks and Matt Forte ran for 150 yards all purpose. Would you think the Jets would lose?
Absolutely the fuck not.
No. That's what really pisses me off.
But I told you that Todd Bowles made some pretty bad coach decisions.
He really doesn't. It showed, like, the blueprint is down of how to beat the Jets this year, at least. But I feel like that's been going on for the past 40 years, because all it is really is let the Jets beat themselves.
It's the same it's the same story every year, only the names change.
Yep.
New York Titans. Oh. Here's the fun fact I was going to say. The last time we lost to the Bengals was 1968. And we've won the last 10 matches between us. And 1968 was actually the year we won our first Super Bowl, then only Super Bowl.
Yeah, 68, 69.
Yep. There's some... So there's some silver lining. Some more silver lining. Last time we lost our season opener was the last time we made the playoffs.
All right, so you know, good things.
This could be good omens.
Don't start 0-2 because that could really bite us in the ass. Because one will be probably last in the AFC
East. Look. I think we lost the last 10 to the Bills, something like that.
It was the last five. We lost the last five to the Bills.
All right, I doubled that. I don't know what.
We're halfway there.
The Bills. Come on, we have to beat them.
Oh, man. Yo, 0-3 against Rex Ryan. Yo, the press will be ready to pounce on us.
Todd Bowles. What a terrible coach.
This is a very pivotal. Fuck me. This is a very pivotal game in Todd Bowles' career. I know it's only week two of his second season, but this is a, like, a huge game for Bowles. Like,
honestly, it might be a shot. Might be a long shot, but not so much because it's the Jets. If they go 0-2, I feel like this is over.
Are we going to lose to Tyrod Taylor again? Really?
Well, I don't see them having any weapons because Sammy Watkins is, he's like not 100%.
He's not 100%, yeah. But I still think they're going to go after Revis.
Of course. You'd be dumb not to. Honestly, you have, if, even if Sammy Watkins is not 100%, he's going to still burn Revis. Yeah. He's going to.
Revis was actually able to contain him.
Yo, just put Revis on the number two. Put Revis on the number two. He'll shut down the number two on most teams. 95% of teams that we face, he'll shut down the number two. The number one, we can just focus the rest of the defense on him. That's it.
Robert Woods, I want to say. What I will say about Revis on Sunday was he looked like a player who knew that he was old, and he looked like he was playing within those limitations. Not only, and I don't only say that because of the play where A.J. Green burnt him for that touchdown. Another play comes to mind where Dalton completed like a short pass to AJ Green. He ran like a little hitch route, but Revis like lost his footing and struggled to like get up and like force him out of bounds. And that's kind of when I was like, all right, like this guy knows he's old and he's playing within those limitations. He's like he wasn't even trying to jam him up at the line anymore.
Which I can respect. But
I do respect.
Don't put him on the number one receiver doing that. That's my issue right now.
But see, I feel like he needs to like switch something up because the way he used to play is not going to work out. And
no, you see, he can't switch that though. That's his game.
It is his game. But
he's wide on Rice. But right now, his Rice is like
it's not working.
It's not.
At least with AJ Green. But see, I can't. Because he made some wild catches that I'm pretty sure no corner could have like even tried.
You could argue that AJ Green is the best receiver Revis will face this year, aside from Antonio Brown.
I don't.
Yeah, that is true. I think so.
This year with the schedule?
Yeah.
Yeah, with this year's schedule.
All right, that might be true. That might be true. But do you think he's still going to hold on to every single number one?
No.
Every single team. That's
no,
what I'm saying.
I don't. Sure realistically, no.
No, they're definitely not going to, like, to the number two either because Tabo seems hard-headed and doesn't want to.
That's the thing, though. Come on, man. Switch the fucking... Honestly, I feel like Cromartie could hold on to that number one receiver better than Revis could right now.
That is a stretch.
I'm just saying... I feel like if Cromartie could do it better.
I think Justin Burns is what could hold on to the That actually wouldn't be a bad idea.
I think Marcus Williams could.
Why not do it? Why not do it? Just have the safeties back you up.
I don't think it should be done during this game.
It's got to be done during this year.
Maybe like.
I think it's something in the game against the Bills. I think it's something that they should mix it up a bit. Like I'm not saying.
I'd say if we're beating up on the Bills, maybe try it a few times, see how it works.
I'm not gonna lie. I don't think we're gonna be beating up on the Bills. I think that as sloppy as the Jets played on Sunday, I think they're gonna play sloppier Thursday, but. But I think the Bills will probably play even sloppier than us.
Do you really think so?
I do. Because those Thursday night games are always sloppy as fuck, man.
Yeah, they are.
Yeah, but
yo,
at the same time, Rex still has a vendetta.
He does, for whatever reason. Because that's all he will that's all he can hope to accomplish as coach of the Bills is to keep the Jets out of the playoffs. Because
that's all he can hope to accomplish as a coach in general. Okay?
Exactly. That's what Carl from Aqua Teen said in Week 17 last year. I remember watching that before the game. He's like, you know, Rex Ryan's gonna want to hold the Jets out of the playoffs because he's been doing it for years. And that is why the Bills are called Stone Cold Lock of the Century of the Week.
I'm sorry, I don't know the last time that we lost to the Bills as much, but...
I
want to predict the winner of 22-17 us this time.
Was actually going to do that.
I'd say 14
next. I think we win... I want to say 22-17 just to reverse the omen. But I think we win like 17-16. I think it's gonna be.
I don't want it that close.
I don't think we have any other choice. I think it's gonna be a really low scoring, sloppy game.
I want to say it's 20-14.
I hope so. I would like to score more than 22 points, just to like. I'd like to see our offense make some sort of progress, because, I mean, as sloppy as the offense was, like, there are definitely, you know, positive things to take away. As good as...
After this preseason, Fitz better step his shit up.
Yeah,
honestly, I was not impressed.
After what?
After this game.
Oh. After the season. I'm like,
no, we can't. After the season, we're going to get a new fucking quarterback. No.
I think do you mean like how he played in the preseason? Because he was pretty suspect in the preseason, too.
No. I'm saying after the preseason with the bullshit that he's been pulling, saying he deserves so much more money, he better step his shit up.
Oh, I agree.
During, like, OTAs and stuff, like, hurt his...
To be honest... OTAs, I really don't think it matters that much that he wasn't there. I mean, also, if you think about Decker and Marshall weren't at OTAs either. So, I mean, I guess it's kind of a double-edged sword. You could say, well, if they were all there together, then maybe they'd be playing better. But at the same time, I kind of just think OTAs don't matter.
I feel time is money, so anytime they could spend together, it helps.
It definitely helps, but at the same time, after OTAs end, there's still like 2 months between OTAs and training camp.
So, yeah, that didn't get together. But also, there's a certain connection between quarterbacks and wide receivers where it's like it's not going to get any better.
Well,
it's not going to get any better.
It would after 1 year of experience with each other. Because they have the same players back. Everyone.
Yeah.
Maybe one or two, three players that start now. Different. That's about
honestly, last year they stood well together. Last year they worked very well together. I thought this season they had worked better together. But now after watching this game, I'm like, you know what? Maybe that was their beat.
Now it's put up or shut up. Tom Bowles got all the players he wanted. They got Mo back. They wanted Mo back. They got him. They wanted Fitz back. They got him. Now it's just...
There's no more excuses. You just...
Yeah, there is no
either excuse. You're going to do it or you're not.
I just feel like the fact that we lost to the Bengals, man.
We should have fucking won that game. How short of a leash would you guys put Fitz on for this season? Like, if he continues to...
I think he's going to do better than last season.
You think the offense will be better than last season?
Yeah.
Eventually, at some point or another, though, it needs to get more vertical. The short intermediate passing game is only going to take you so far. Eventually, you're going to have to.
Yeah.
You're just going to have to.
Our run game might not be as strong. I mean, Forte looked good.
The thing with that is,
Forte looked good.
Forte looked great, but the thing I will say is
Forte,
I feel like
Forte.
I feel like we don't have like a workhorse running back anymore, and I feel like that's something we're gonna miss.
Definitely.
Also, we should probably start using tight ends.
remember that position?
I mean, the NFL is moving forward.
Who do you want to use?
I mean, we don't have anyone. That's the problem.
We've attempted a pass to kill this, and it went over his head again.
I remember Amara was supposed to be the next fucking, like, nah, he was supposed to be, you know, Shockey, but still.
Cut his head.
He is such trash. But are you ready for Marcus Mariota to throw the touchdown, the game-winning touchdown to Jason Morrow in Super Bowl 55? It's gonna
that
happen.
Happens.
It's gonna happen.
55?
Yeah, Super Bowl 55. I'm giving them 4 years. No, I'm just saying, I'm giving them 4 years to I'm giving the Titans 4 years to win a Super Bowl, is what I'm saying.
Like, they get better. If they can increase their defense, like they've increased their offense, they can be definitely a formidable team.
Exactly. They got Mariota. They're putting the pieces together. They just, you know, it'll take some time, but...
Yeah, but I'd be more scared of the Bucks.
I think the Bucks are going to the playoffs this year. I think they're taking a wild card spot.
But see, what really hurt us about losing to the Bengals is that they're probably going to be a wild card team.
Yep. Exactly.
Yeah, and that's a crucial tiebreaker. Now it's kind of a double-edged with the game of Cincy and Pittsburgh this weekend. It's kind of a double-edged sword because you need Pittsburgh to win you need Pittsburgh to win because, you know, Cincy holds the tiebreaker, but at the same time, like, if Pittsburgh does win that game, it increases the chances that Cincy will be a wild card, and that tiebreaker will come into effect. So really, we found ourselves in a situation where here in week two, we're fucked no matter what happens in games that should have nothing to do with us, but they do.
Yeah. Right now, our fate's in our own hands.
Oh, of course it is. I mean, it's week two. It's too early to be getting into this shit, this is shit that it could come down to later in the year.
Yeah.
We have week three. No, week four is the Seahawks.
Yeah. Yo, I have us being the Seahawks.
Week three.
I don't. I want to, but.
They just beat the Dolphins.
They barely beat the Dolphins, and Russell Wilson is hurt now. We just have to hope we get out of week six at 3-3, and then take it from there.
What would have been worse too is because Tyler Eifert was out and Fontez Burfict.
It was a missed opportunity. We had a depleted Bengals team, and we couldn't take advantage of it.
Well, we do get Sheldon back for this game.
We do.
Yeah.
I'm predicting...
We just dominate our front seven even more. So...
I'm predicting nine sacks.
Our entire season depends on our defense.
But Tyrod Taylor's fast, so... I'd say three.
Yeah, I was kind of joking, but
I wouldn't mind nine, but three.
We'll have less sacks. I think it's going to be more about it's going to be more about containing Tyrod Taylor than it is about putting pressure on him.
Right.
And with all the weapons we have on D line, we should be able to do a good job of containing him.
The only thing is the receivers are going to break apart from the corners.
That's the issue. Secondary.
Speaking
of punting, at least that upgraded a lot.
Oh yeah, that's actually
our punt is pretty good.
Of all the positive takeaways to take from this game, I feel like that's one nobody's talking about is our new punter. It's one of those Aussies, right?
Lakeland.
Yeah.
He's got a boot, man.
He does.
Yeah. So kind of just an NFL thing. I'm sure we can all agree that moving the touchback to the 25-yard line is so gay.
Yeah.
I hate it.
Yeah. I've never met a football fan that didn't disagree with that statement.
Yeah.
What I really think kickers. I know we discussed this. I know me and you discussed this, Justin, when they moved kicks up to the 35-yard line, like when they first did that. But I really think you're going to start to see kickers try and boot it high and, like, right around, like, the goal line.
That's the thing. I don't understand why it hasn't happened yet.
I don't understand either.
Learn how to do that.
Maybe. There's got to be like the physics studies for them to figure out that sort of thing.
It can't be impossible.
Oh, I'm not saying. That's what I'm saying. I'm saying like, you know, with physics and everything, they should be able to figure out a way to kick the ball in which they can, you know, kick it high and kick it like between like, you know, kick it between like the 5-yard line and the goal line, like. It should be doable.
For even 5, you can kick it within the 10. It's going to be high enough that your defense, the special team, is going to get there.
Yeah, and then all you got to do is, stop them before the 25, and it's a successful play. Yeah.
Forget 25. You can definitely stop them before the 20. Think about how high the ball's got to go, the hang time to be there for it to be kicked. It's dumb. Eventually, it will be changed because kickers will just grow to be able to do that.
If they do that though, then they're just going to get rid of kickoffs.
And yeah.
And that's just a whole separate issue.
It's so dumb. They might get hurt. Oh God, they're playing football. So dumb. That's why you don't use your number 1-2 receivers on the fucking kickoffs. Don't fucking die.
Oh, man. This is where they just end up kicking most of these kickoffs into the end zone.
It sucks, because it ruins an entire position. There are motherfuckers that, like, that was all they could do.
Yeah, like Dante Hall and like Devin Hester.
Yep. Like who's the dude who's on the Seahawks?
Drawing
a blank.
Who's the dude?
You mean like now or was?
No, was.
How?
No. Was on Seahawks? Was enough. Leon Washington.
Oh yeah, he was a Jet. You know, we traded Leon Washington to the Seahawks, and we used that draft pick to pick Joe McKnight.
Yes. Yo, I love McKnight. I'm sorry. I love McKnight.
Yo, the best was when he tried to when Joe McKnight tried to fight Manish Mehta, the Jets beat writer. He tweeted at him. He's like, "Yo, you outside?" Like saying, he's like,
"You try to fight him?"
Yeah, Joe McKnight was trying. He was trying to fight a Jets beat writer. Like he tweeted at him. He's like, "Yo, you outside right now? Like, come see me."
How did I miss this?
It happened in like, like 2012 training camp, I think.
I think it was like 2011.
Was it 2011? I thought 2011 was when he like still semi had his shit together.
No. I think it was. Oh yeah, maybe you're right.
Also, I almost forgot to mention this. The New York Jets added me on Twitter.
Yeah.
And they told me. I asked them if we eaten, and they assured me that we were eating, and we did not.
Shit,
we did not eat. So real quick,
you get nothing.
I have a song to play. This song is for the New York Jets. You may have heard it before. Give me one sec here. I got this song.
Yes, yeah, Cody.
Yeah, this song is for the Jets. There we go. It took forever for the song to actually start.
That's your BMW? Mm, that's nice. That's your girl?
Oh, man.
Oh, wait. I just want to know one thing. You ready? Why the fuck you lying? Why you always lying? Oh, my God. Stop fucking lying. Always lying to me. Lying so much. You making it hard for me. Yeah. Every time you tell me something, I figure that you're lying. Who is almost lying? Faking. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I know you're lying. But you sound excited, and you know that I know that you're lying. Oh, girl. Cue the ring.
Honestly.
I wish they
people are lying.
And just keep doing that over and
over. Yeah. Maybe it's late.
Because I don't need to hear this dude sing.
No. Yo, but what's their name? They actually did a version of it. What was it? B2K actually did the regular version. They did a Why You Lying version of it.
Oh yeah, there's definitely like a loop of it because this is like that was like the official full length song. I should have probably did a little more research and found the loop version. There's a Vine compilation.
The new Jay that came out got those. I got, why the fuck you lying? Why you always lying? Oh my God. Stop fucking lying. Yeah. Why the fuck you lying? Why you always lying?
In 2020, to run for president.
Why the fuck you lying? Why you always... How do you say don't lie to me? Yeah, that's Kanye's year.
Yo, it's going to be Kanye versus Trump.
Oh, Lord. Trump for re-election.
And what's your excuse going to be then to not vote for Ralph Nader? Or Jill Stein or Gary Johnson or...
Yeah, I'm a Gary Johnson motherfucker. This is fun.
Yeah, I always flip back and forth between Gary and Jill.
That's why I'm independent.
I registered Democrat just to vote for Bernie, who
I think I registered Democrat back in like when I was like eligible to vote, but
I usually vote Democrat anyways.
Yeah, I'm gonna drop Gary this year definitely without a doubt.
You could just write in Harambe and like take a Snapchat of it.
Yeah, I wanted to write myself in, but you know.
Yeah. Speaking of which,
I'd rather put someone possible.
Yo, at the game, there was so much, like, slander against Cincinnati for killing Harambe.
Oh, yeah.
Like on the way up to the, when me and Frank, like, went into the stadium, we were right behind the dude who had a white tee, and on the back he wrote hashtag Cincinnati killed Harambe. It was on my Snapchat story. I also saw Justin, you would love this. Someone was wearing a Sanchez jersey, but over Sanchez's name, they duct taped Harambe Jr. onto it.
That is great. That actually makes me wish that I have a monkey suit. I wish I wore that to the game.
Oh, you should have. Dude, if you would have done that.
I wore that to the game.
We would have won if you would have done that.
You need to look this up right now. It was so funny. Kevin Harlan, the announcer at the game last night for the 49ers Rams.
Yeah.
Oh, I got.
That ran out on the field. And he starts like.
He's
at the 30. Oh, he's taking his shirt off. This guy is fun. They tackled him at the 20.
Yeah,
that was hilarious.
I'm pretty sure it's on my Twitter somewhere, like the whole video.
I heard about that. I just found it. I am putting it on right now.
I didn't listen to that. That shit was hilarious.
This guy had to.
The Niners with the Rams? What?
Yeah. Here, Justin, banging his chest, now runs the opposite way. He runs to the 50, he runs to the 40. The guy is drunk, but there he goes. The 20, they're chasing him. They're not going to get him. Waving his arms.
Here, oh, my God.
Out there, that's the blue coat. Oh, they got him. They're coming from the left. Oh, and they tackle him at the 40-yard line.
That was the most exciting thing to happen tonight.
I tell you what, that was a great call on your part. That was a great call. All right, I'm ready for the last 11:31 now, Kevin. Let's go.
Look at the police. They've surrounded this man like he is... like he's just robbed a bank.
I tell you what, he got a whole lap in.
He did.
He got him. That was pretty good. I expected him to go down much sooner.
Yeah. But I hope it was worth it, my friend, because you got a night and the click coming up.
All right, maybe that'll change things for the Rams.
Yeah, I'll do it some land.
That was amazing. I read about that. That was the first time I heard it, though, and that... That's probably the best thing to happen in this opening week of football.
Absolutely.
That and Antonio Brown twerking is up there.
Oh, all right. I wanted to talk about Leonard Williams real quick. Do you think he already has 2.5 sacks?
Steroids. Yeah.
Do you think he's on steroids? I just think
he's on steroids.
Big ass dude. He's like 6'5", 300 some pounds. But do you think by the end of this season, you're like, because you can see him taking that like next level?
Yeah, I think.
Yeah, he should have taken that next level a couple years ago.
I think he's already there. To be honest,
I think he is.
I think, I mean, especially since we got Muhammad Wilkerson locked up, I mean, I think now remember how the question was, do we keep Mo or do we keep Sheldon? I think now the question is, do we keep Leonard or do we keep Sheldon? And I think Sheldon might be the, I hate to say it, I think he might be the odd man out.
But the thing is, he's still working around.
Yeah, he is, because he's like a hybrid. You could put him on, like, DN, D-tackle, or, like, even outside linebacker sometimes.
Unless he starts playing, like, shit.
Yeah.
Unless he comes in and he's absolute shit, then he's still working around.
The only reason I would say they'd keep Leonard over Sheldon, I mean, it really is a tough decision because they're just
because of his off field bullshit.
Yeah, that's really the only reason why.
Yeah.
I still can't believe he only got one game for that shit.
Yeah, at least
But Levy and Bell is suspended.
How dumb is that?
But Levy and Bell is suspended for 3 games because like he changed his phone number and they couldn't take a drug test or something.
Yep.
Speaking of drug tests.
It's all right. You see, if endangered a minor while he did that, you'd only get one.
Yeah, or if he beat his wife like Josh Brown.
The NFL is so corrupt as it started.
They really are right up there with FIFA. Like not as bad, but. Because FIFA's on a way more global scale,
FIFA's on a global scale, but
and they're like oppressing like third world like countries FIFA, and
you're
shit.
You're gonna get your shit fucked. Like that shit doesn't happen to FIFA. The fact that like you'll get penalized for it.
Yeah, I'm sure there's. You probably know
on a higher management level.
You probably know better than I do because you follow that shit more, but I'm sure there's way less inconsistencies with punishment for off-the-field behavior in FIFA than there is in the NFL.
Yeah,
I would say so.
Definitely. Although, you can get away with tax fraud easily in FIFA.
that shit's, like, encouraged.
That's just so absurd to me. I'm sorry. Yeah, you're making that much money. How don't you just pay your taxes? Like, you're going to live comfortably anyways. Shut the fuck up and pay your taxes. I'm like, yo, Neymar, what the fuck are you guys doing?
I'm telling you. You should tell them to hit you up. Like, be like, yo, I'll do this for you.
Players in the world for sports in general.
Like, seriously. Like, what the fuck are you doing?
What is he spending his money on? Like
nothing. He has that money in reserves. Like, you know, this is tax money. This is tax money. I just don't feel like spending it. Oh, I spend it now? Okay, here you go. Like, no. Just pay your taxes, man. Just pay your taxes. It's simple. Pay your motherfucking taxes. You want to pay for La Liga? Pay them Spanish taxes. That's it.
Taxation is theft, Justin.
Shit.
Taxation is theft.
I spend like so much money every single weekend, like 100 hookers and add coke.
They're making like a quarter mil a week.
Probably like after every game, because you know they play multiple games a week sometimes.
They're making such dumb money. It's absurd.
I know they get like 3 times the amount of NFL players do as well.
What? And like, yeah, Chelsea was looking to get Messi. Chelsea was looking to get Messi, and they were saying they're going to pay him. I think the amount was like a little less than half a mil a week.
What?
For the 36 games for the league?
Yeah.
A week. Negro, come on, son.
Negro, please.
That's how much like benched wide receivers get a whole
year. Yeah, that's like he's getting the veteran minimum for an NFL player in a week.
Basically.
In a week. Like 400 or 500K.
And what's I can't even fucking remember the I can't remember the fucking Chelsea owner right now.
So what they were gonna get him, but like they couldn't because they didn't pay taxes. Is that how it went down?
Oh no! You see, Messi was thinking about leaving because Barcelona didn't support him when he didn't pay his taxes.
They should have supported him.
So it's like, wait, I didn't pay my taxes, and you guys don't want to support me. I might leave him.
Honestly, that kind of makes me like him more. Respect.
I feel like he's just doing that to make an excuse of him.
Yo, honestly, I don't understand why Messi doesn't leave La Liga. Hey, you might not know. This is obviously out of your field, but okay, La Liga is filled with Two teams.
La Liga is two teams that just dominate the whole league.
Yeah. sometimes a third team, which is basically the equivalent of...
Which is like Atletico Madrid.
Yeah. I'm trying to think of the NFL equivalent. It would be like the Ravens coming in and winning.
The Ravens?
Are you trying to make like an AFC North analogy to La Liga or something?
No, I'm talking about the entire NFL league.
Okay, because the Ravens might not be a good example.
Exactly. No, Atletico's not a good team, but they could win. Just because soccer is...
So you want to, like, equate them to an NFL team, I'd say they're, like...
The Jets.
Nah. The Jets would be, like, fucking Sevilla.
Liverpool.
They'd be, like, I guess you could say, like, the Bengals.
Like the Panthers. Or, like, the Panthers. They're that team that could win, but never does.
It would be... All right. You know, yes. It'd be the Bengals, because the Bengals keep getting to the playoffs, but...
And they keep losing.
Yeah.
Or like the Colts, when they would always make the playoffs and lose every year.
Exactly. That would be perfect there.
That is perfect.
The Colts,
or like the Atlanta Braves of, like, the 90s.
Yep.
So, speaking of baseball, just while we're on the topic, did anyone see... Gary Sanchez hit a sack fly on an intentional walk pitch.
Yeah.
Dude, that was one of the coolest things I've ever seen.
I didn't see it. I heard about that.
But just so the listeners know, we're on the bullshit part of the Jets and Bullshit podcast.
Oh, yeah.
It was so bad. Like, the Rays pitcher was, like, trying to throw an intentional walk pitch, but, like, he hung that shit, like, dick high. Granted, it was like outside, but it was still dick high, and Gary Sanchez was just like, boink. I thought it was a dinger at first.
But it wasn't all run.
No, it was just a sack fly.
That would have been dope.
Just a sack fly. I only got a ribby off your intentional walk attempt.
Yes.
Honestly, I would tell my coach, yo, take me out.
The look on his face was... The look on the pitcher's face was so priceless.
I don't want to pitch anymore. I was trying to walk him, and he just got a ribby.
I fucking quit.
That's crazy. Honestly, I don't have too much respect for baseball.
I don't know why you don't.
I read a notification... I think yesterday, that said some outfielder was out for 3 to 4 weeks on a mild elbow strain.
That's... who?
I don't even remember.
Probably
just like an estimate.
I bet it was just someone who... I bet it was just someone who sucked and they needed an excuse to keep him out.
The strain. I'm sorry. Baseball.
Oh, can we talk about how the Red Sox real quick?
Was it? I mean, was it, you said it was an outfielder?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it's an outfielder. But still, a mild elbow strain.
Where'd you get it on Team Stream?
I want to know who it was, because I mean, if it's someone if it was someone on like a trash ass team that has no chance of being in the playoff race, then yeah, just shut him down for the season. No need to risk that shit.
But the thing is, like, that's a risk.
Oh, the Yankees beat the Dodgers.
Yeah, they hit three dongs and CC pitched a shutout. I don't think it was a complete game shutout, but we shut him out.
Oh, is CC doing well now?
I mean, he didn't give up any runs tonight, so I guess. I think he needs to become a fat alcoholic again.
Yes, he does.
Speaking of
Bartolo, learn from Bartolo. Okay, dude, you see Bartolo right now?
Big Sexy. But yeah. Did you hear Rex Ryan? Rex Ryan got rid of his lap band.
I heard about that.
Did you hear what he said? He was like, he was like, everyone.
How about his brother?
He was like, yeah, he was like, I want to. Yeah, it was like something about like standing in solidarity with his brother. But he he was like, everyone knows that I won more games when I was fat. He's like, I'll do anything to help the squad out.
No, he didn't say that.
He's
still not going to be as fat as he was in, what, 4 days?
Yo, I hope he gets that fat again. I really do.
Yo, the dude...
I can't wait for Rex to wheel Kampali out on a wheelchair as one of the honorary team captains for this game on Thursday. That is such a Rex Ryan move.
Were you talking? You said he had a right oblique strain?
Who?
No.
A mild elbow strain.
Oh.
I'm sorry, yo. Baseball players go down for the hands down most pussiest injuries there ever are, okay? I don't care what anybody. People will fucking shit on soccer. Like, oh, they take these dives. At least they're not out for 3 or 4 fucking weeks off these.
They get up right after the dives, yeah. And they're like, yeah, I was just trying to draw a foul.
Yeah, they do. They do it for a foul, yes. Okay, you can call them bitches. I played soccer for my life. Never took a dive, ever. But in baseball, they actually go down and then they go out for these injuries. If you're a pitcher, I can understand that. You have an elbow strain, you have elbow inflammation, elbow contusion. Okay, yes, I can understand that. That's your entire game.
But what I can't stand pitchers doing is pulling their innings limit shit. Like, remember when Matt Harvey wasn't going to pitch in the playoffs last year because he was on an innings limit? Or a couple...
I was really tight about that.
A couple of years ago, the Nash... I think it was 2011. I'm pretty sure it was either 2011 or 2012. It was either the year the Cardinals won the World Series, or it was the year after when the Giants won. But either way, the Cardinals played the Nationals in a playoff series, and Strasburg had already reached his 200 innings limit, so he just didn't. So he just didn't play in the playoffs. It's like, dude, the point is, like, to win a championship.
Exactly.
I would fucking blow both of my elbows out and never be able to pitch again if it meant to win a World Series.
For one.
Yeah, for one World Series.
Yeah. Seriously. I mean, look, okay, I'm not saying baseball is not a hard sport. Yes, it is. But... hands down, the only position that deserves to go out for injuries like that is a fucking pitcher.
It's the only position important enough.
Well, I think it's like the opposite because, like, see, baseball players, what they do is they stand around a lot. They don't move as much as other sports do. And I think they tighten up. So, like, if they do a fast...
It's very static.
Bullshit. They pull a lot of shit. And... The only position I
can
see not getting injured like that is the pitcher
because
he's always pitching.
but he's always giving his all. Which upsets me. He's whipping his arm every single fucking pitch. 100 pitches? Yo. Show me a quarterback that'll whip his arm like that 100 times.
Ryan Fitzpatrick.
In that many hours, and just be like, okay, yeah, I'm ready to pitch again in 5 days.
Ryan Fitzpatrick.
Rich, I'm sorry,
Rich, Rich Gannon.
Let me rephrase that. Pitch that well. Again.
Rich Gannon. In 2002.
Rich Gannon. And maybe Jamarcus Russell probably had, like, the best arms.
Jamarcus Russell did throw the ball 75 feet from his knees. From his knees. It doesn't matter if it wasn't to anyone. I mean,
no, honestly, if you give Rich Gannon just like Randy Nelson TO for one season, he could probably get a Super Bowl.
Probably. I mean, shit, he almost did it. He almost did it with Jerry Rice and Tim Brown. I mean, I shouldn't say almost, because the Bucks absolutely destroyed them that game, but he got him there.
He got him there, exactly.
And guess who they beat along the way?
The Bucks defense was phenomenal.
That was one of the, honestly, I know everyone talks about the 85 Bears and the 2000 Ravens and shit, even the 2013 Seahawks. I think the 2002 Bucks should be in that conversation.
Definitely, without a doubt. What's his name? Who had like two, three interceptions?
There was two of them. They're Dexter Jackson and Dwight Smith. Dwight Smith had two pick sixes that game. Dexter Jackson only won the MVP because they closed out the voting like before the game ended. But Dwight Smith should have been the MVP because he had two pick sixes in that game.
Yeah.
And then he had the one at the end, which like a lot of people lost a lot of money over.
If you have two pick sixes in any game, you're the MVP.
Yeah.
Any game.
Hands down.
You're the MVP of that game.
Doesn't matter if the quarterback throws for like 400 yards.
Doesn't matter.
I agree.
The MVP of that game. You had two fucking pick sixes. I'm sorry. When does that happen? Never.
Who's their quarterback? Brad Johnson.
It was Brad Johnson, yes. And Warwick Dunn was their running back?
Yes, Warwick Dunn.
Didn't they have Mike Allstott too as fullback?
Yeah, that was yo, back in the A Train days.
You can't shit Allstott.
No, I'm saying, yeah,
no,
he was a beast.
Yeah, Allstott was a beast, man.
Speaking of Mike Allstott, that Denver fullback who scored that touchdown, that shit was amazing. He ran into the end zone like carrying the ball like a loaf of bread, and he just had like the biggest smile on his face.
I didn't see that. That was the against the Panthers.
Yeah, in the opening game, it was the first touchdown the Broncos scored. It was like
That's why I missed it then.
It was like a third and one, and they were just doing a fullback dive, probably just trying to pick up like that 1 yard real quick. And he just had a hole, and he just took it.
Oh, speaking of fullbacks, can we talk about why we got rid of Tommy Bohannon?
Seriously, what the fuck?
Like, I don't get why they made that decision. He was good. He was good on picking up blocks.
Yeah, we could have.
He even made catches when he had to.
He really did. He would make those fullback flat catches that you ask your fullback to make, like, once every four games or something.
Is he playing right now?
No, I don't think so.
So no one picks him up. That's a dumb move.
Nobody really uses fullbacks. Wow. Yo, we need to bring back fullbacks. If we're not going to use tight ends, we should use. Yeah, we should at least use fullbacks.
You said it right. If you're not going to use a fullback.
Or if we're not going to use a tight end.
If you're not going to use a tight end, bring back a good fucking fullback.
Right. Or, here's an idea. What if we kept Tommy Bohannon and made him like a hybrid fullback tight end? I mean, he's good enough at blocking. He's good enough at catching passes.
He's not quick enough to be a tight end. In certain sets, like where he's obviously going to be going out for a pass, you can't toss him out there.
I feel that Anunoabu could play tight end too.
I mean, he kind of is like a hybrid tight end.
I feel like
if the other team sees Anunoabu in as a tight end, they can be like, okay, he's coming out for a pass. And that's my only issue with Anunoabu being tight end. I feel like it's not gonna be like, okay, you know,
he's here to block.
He's most likely going out for a pass,
and he's not. And I feel like he's not like good enough. I do like Anunoabu a lot. I'm not gonna lie, I do like Anunoabu a lot, but I don't think he's good enough that like, you know, you could fool teams like that. Like,
yeah,
that you could be like, oh, he's going out for a pass as a tight end, and you know, and he'll catch it anyway.
Or maybe they're trying to use him as a fullback.
I'd be
open. I did see him playing some halfback.
I'd be open to it, like some H back. You mean?
Yeah.
I'd be open to it. Shit. If we're not going to use tight ends, anything is possible.
Yeah. we need to revolutionize the game.
Yes.
We need to change something in the game where defenses have to adapt, but they're not ready for it.
The Jets already revolutionized the game of football. It's called the butt fumble.
And you were there for that. Oh, I'm so glad I was not there for that.
I ditched my family on Thanksgiving to see that shit. Yeah, I remember seeing it.
That's what you get. That's what you get, Hecker. You left your family, man, and you got the butt fumble, man.
I witnessed the butt fumble. I also saw one of two grand slams that Mariano Rivera gave up in his career, like in person.
What?
Yeah, damn. I have.
What a bad weekend.
I have some really bad.
I go to no good games. I went to the Christmas Eve game, the Jets versus the Giants. Shit, and I saw Victor Cruz score that like 100-yard touchdown.
Yeah.
Freezing my ass off. Fuck this
motherfucker. Yeah, that one hurt. Actually, the game Sunday against the Bengals, that was the first Jets game that they lost that I was at where they weren't playing the Patriots. The only other Jets losses I've been at were Patriots games.
Damn, you missed the last one.
Yeah, actually, yeah. Yeah, I stopped going to Patriots games because I was like, oh, like, maybe if I stop going, we'll win. And
we did.
Yeah.
Yep. I might not have ever seen the Jets win live. No. I watched the Browns game last season. Thank God. All right.
Wait, Justin, weren't you at that, Justin, weren't you at the, in 2010 when we went 11-5 and we rested all our starters in week 17? Weren't you at that game?
In 2010?
It was week 17 of the 2010 season. We played the Bills in the last week of the season, but we rested all our starters. Like, Mark Brunell started that game. Wait.
I thought we went
11-5.
I think Shannon bought me those tickets.
Actually, no, Justin. We were at the... Justin, we were at the Jets-Saints game in 2013 when they won. So we were at a game together where the Jets won.
Oh, shit. I barely remember that game.
Matarlo went to that game.
Oh, yes. Because yes,
he had his...
oh, my God, yeah.
He had his Halloween party the night before, and then we just all, like, spontaneously decided, like, oh, let's go to the Jets game. And then that was the cheap ticket. That was the cheaptickets.com game. You got those tickets off cheaptickets.com, and then, like...
Well, I was almost chipped out of those fucking tickets.
Yeah, didn't they, like, reimburse you for those?
Yeah, they did.
Yeah, because, you got gypped out of the tickets.
I was so tight for so long over that shit.
And then we just got other tickets, and we had an extra ticket. So we were like, hey, Matarlo, you want to, like, come this jet?
And I got drunk. I was like, yo, fuck that, man. That's money down the drain. And then a couple days later, I got my money back. Thank God. That was some bullshit, man.
How much were the tickets for that? Maybe it's
because
I wasn't there.
Because
we needed the whole Jets and Bullshit podcast.
If you did the thing that my friends did, you'd pay $80. But if you did the smart thing that Hecker did, you'd only pay $10.
Yes.
You only paid $10?
I got $10 tickets the night before the game.
What? All right.
It was the luckiest thing ever. I was... Because I asked them...
It's called you wait to buy the tickets because it's not when you sold out.
It was totally luck because aside from those $10 tickets, all the other tickets were like $60. Like, I just... Like, it was like $10 tickets and then it was $60 tickets. I just
two days before, I found tickets that were 50. I found tickets that were 50, and I'm like, why am I spending $80 on a ticket?
When I can, you said how long before? Like
2 days. 2 days before.
Yeah, yeah, and they bought those. Yeah, who bought those tickets? Nick.
Nick, yeah.
And he bought them what? Like he bought them in like July or something, right?
He bought them in August, and not only that, he also bought the parking passes. Which, when he got the parking pass and they actually told the face value on them, were $35. Guess how much he spent on them?
$50. How much?
$85
for the parking passes.
Each two
parking passes.
So he spent $100 more than necessary.
What, for his car and Gavin's car?
For Gavin's car and Kevin's car.
What a mess.
$85 apiece. Are you kidding me? That's retarded.
That's why we lost. Because you gave him too much money.
So dumb.
Yeah, that shit's retarded.
Like, honestly, you think the Jets opener is going to be sold out?
It never does.
No, so why would you buy that early?
Unless we're hanging a Super Bowl banner, it's never going to sell
out. It's not going to sold out, exactly.
Even if it is sold out, there's always going to be that secondary market.
Yeah. Not only that, scalping tickets will be cheaper than that shit.
Yeah. That's why, like, when like, when you told me the whole, like, oh, like, buy my ticket and I'm going to buy tickets with these people, I was like, you know what, let me just see if, like, Frank wants to go real quick. If Frank would have said, like, oh, no, I can't, I would have just bought your $80 ticket. But then Frank was like, oh, yeah, I'm down. I was like, all right, cool, I'll check tickets. And then I saw, like, there was, like, one set of two tickets available for $10. I was like, I am getting this.
Not only that, but I've never, I mean, this is the first time, but I've never been to a Jet game where I haven't gone down to the first level.
Yeah, we actually, I remember, because we were, like, looking at halftime, or I know you were, but, like, we were going to at least make it to the second level if we would have went down the right set of stairs.
You usually go at halftime.
Yeah, you have to at least wait to halftime. You got to give them some respect. And then other than that, you just walk in there like you don't give a shit.
Yeah, just walk in there like, yeah, we've been here the whole time. We missed we missed the whole third quarter because we were like trying to upgrade seats. And then we were like, you know what? It's about to be the fourth quarter. Let's just go back to our section.
It was an adventure. The only thing I remember of that is the fact that we got down there and it wasn't. We weren't able to get to the field.
There was no access to sections. Like that was like an express. Yeah. That was like an express stairway to the exit of the stadium. It was.
I just remember being angry about that, and that's it.
If we would have went down like any other stairway, we would have. We would have got something.
Any Jets game I go to, I always go down. They don't give a fuck.
They really don't.
They really don't.
I mean, Pat Bradley's a security guard. Jess is a security guard. Like those are the type.
Jess?
Yeah. That's how I met Pat. Like. Because they work together, so, like, she invited him over one day. And that's, like, how we became friends.
Pat's an awesome dude.
Yeah.
Love Pat. Pat's awesome. Even though he's a Tottenham fan. Like, who the fuck is a Tottenham fan?
Yeah, I actually watched that Spurs game with him the other day where they beat Stoke City, like, 4-0. And the coach...
Yo.
And the
he's a
Spurs fan, like not the NBA Spurs, but the Tottenham Spurs, whatever.
He likes Tottenham.
Yeah,
right.
That's bad, Brandon.
But I mean, you're an Arsenal fan, so you're just as bad.
Me? No, I'm a Liverpool fan.
Yo, Liverpool all fucking day. My only ties to soccer, like I would be a Liverpool fan just because my my godfather is like from England, and he got me like a Liverpool Football Club shirt when I was like when I was a young lad. So that's like my only ties to any soccer team. So if I'm gonna root for a soccer team, it's Liverpool.
Yeah,
well, it would be fitting for you because Liverpool does have like the most championships out of all English out of all English Premier League teams.
Do they? I thought they were like trash.
No, no, they're like the Yankees. If the Yankees fell off,
yeah. Well, the Yankees were falling off, well, and then the whole baby bombers movement started.
Look, they're doing good, but they ain't getting no fucking championship anytime soon.
The Yankees?
No, not with Miguel as a fucking goalkeeper. Hell no.
I'm pretty sure Liverpool beat Barcelona like 4-0 with Messi.
What?
And Neymar.
When?
And when? Like a month ago?
Crazy. They couldn't even play. A month ago was fucking preseason.
And Suarez was playing.
Suarez might have played. I don't know if Messi.
Sadio Mane killed him. This African dude. Yo, we got this African dude from Senegal. Yo, he's new.
Yo, you guys hands down have, like, possibly the worst keeper out of any good team.
We beat Arsenal.
In all the leagues. Atletico Madrid has a better keeper than you guys do.
We beat Arsenal a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, but Arsenal's trash too, man.
Arsenal just got Ibrahimovic.
No. Ibra's on Man U.
Oh, yeah, you're right. It is Man U. Well, we'll watch Man U too, so.
Yo, if Man U wins Premier League, I'll be so excited.
It will kill Jordan Nelson.
No. Not a chance, man. Not a chance. Chelsea's doing. Are you kidding me? Have you seen Hazard this season? Have you seen him this season so far? Don't get me started.
I know he's trash in the when he played on Belgium. It's trash now.
Yo, Belgium is about to be my team. I love France. Love France to death. I root for them always. But
I was front running like for Belgium until
Belgium is about to be my second team, man. Hazard, Courtois. Fucking who's Benteke sucks ass. He's on Liverpool. Fucking what's the other dude's name? I can't even think of his name right now. Damn. Yo, obviously Company's dope, but there's someone else. There's I think it's midfielder.
You're talking about Mertens?
Mertens is dope. De Bruyne. De Bruyne.
Oh, the blonde haired dude, the red haired dude?
Yeah.
Yeah. He's on
I think he's on a German team.
No, I
can't remember what club team he's on, but De Bruyne.
I just saw him playing. I forgot what team it was. Maybe it was an English team.
And Lukaku. Lukaku should still be on Chelsea. I think we just traded him away. I think we made the trade like finalized last season. But Lukaku should be a dope player.
I think he's on Manchester City.
De Bruyne?
Yeah.
Yo, both Manchesters this season are going to be doing work, and I don't like that.
Yo,
I don't like Manchester at all.
Fuck Man U. I mean,
yes.
Yeah,
I don't know shit about soccer, but fuck Man U.
That's all you need to know about soccer.
Yeah, that is all you need to know. That's my sister's team. Fuck
it. Might be like a weird comparison, but I kind of feel the same way about Man U that I feel about Penn State football. I fucking hate Penn State, dude. Like, if I'm going to root for any college football team, it's Pitt because I live here and my two favorite Jets went to Pitt. But, like, I hate Penn State more than I like Pitt.
I was actually going to go to Penn State, but they didn't give me enough money.
Good, so fuck them.
Like, literally, like, each semester, like, 45 Gs, and they only gave me, like, 4,500. Like, oh, yeah, it was, like, 10%. I'm like,
That's not going to work.
You know I got into Clark?
You got in Clark?
Yeah, because I said I was... back on my application. And
affirmative action.
Because, you know, like, Clark is a historically black school, right?
Yeah.
And the same reason they want to give me, you know, money. Yo, it's pretty hard to get into that school, too.
Yeah.
And I wasn't trying to go all the way in hot-ass Atlanta.
Yo, Justin, do you want to hear why, you want to hear the story behind how Sheldon ended up going to Adelphi?
Yeah.
Because of all the schools he got accepted into, it was the first one alphabetically. So he just picked, that one.
Yeah, that's pretty funny.
Yes, Sheldon, yes.
Isn't that amazing? Anyway, back to the Bills game. So I know it's week two, and I know, like, a couple of podcasts ago in the preseason we said that this was a must win.
It is a must win.
I hate to put that label on a game in week two, but it really is a must win. If we don't win this game, I'm gonna break things. It's not gonna be good.
I mean,
especially the fact that those lost.
Every game should be.
You what?
But at least we should go in with that same mentality each game.
Yeah.
I mean, yeah, we should win every game. We should have beat the Bengals.
I'm sorry, how the Pats win?
Dude, I don't even know. I didn't see the game. I didn't see any of the highlights either. I just saw. I got home at like 2 in the morning and saw that they fucking won.
Of week one.
I don't know how they won, but that kind of gives me hope for us, like, having a good game against them.
Fuck hope. They should have lost. They should lose the first four games of this fucking season. I'm really excited that Garoppolo came out like, yo, man, I look like a better quarterback than a lot of quarterbacks in the fucking NFL right now.
Who are they playing next to? The Dolphins?
They're gonna win that game too, so they'll be 2-0. So chances are the Patriots are just gonna win 13 games again, and we're just gonna.
I had talking about Dolphins. I had hopes of fucking Aaron Foster. I had hopes that he'd come
come back to life.
Well, you never know, because sometimes there are these games where Ryan Tannehill will just go off. I remember he did it last year.
That is true, but I was thinking the O-line would be doing work. I thought their O-line.
I thought their O-line would have been doing work.
Honestly, no, their O-line's.
I think Miami's D-line is, like, kind of overrated.
Yeah,
I think the Dolphins O-line's overrated?
Yeah, I do.
Really?
They have good players, but they. Like, yeah, they have Sue, and they have Cameron, and they have Cameron Wake, but, like, yeah, as a unit, they always underperform.
Yeah, I mean, that is true. That is true. But still, I had that feeling that Aaron Foster was going to do work with him.
Yeah, it's kind of weird because, like, Lamar Miller's on the Texans now and Arian Foster's on the Dolphins, and it was kind of one of those situations where it's like both of them should be better now on their respective teams than they were before.
Yeah.
Because I always thought Lamar Miller was trash on the Dolphins.
But now he's doing good on the Texans.
It just never worked. And now the Texans, he's not. Well, it's only week one.
Yeah, it's only week one. It's really hard. I don't even know what his numbers were in week one. Like, I don't even know how he did.
A lot of shit changes after week one because, like, you'll see those players that just go off and then you'll never hear from them again.
Yeah, like, remember Kevin Ogletree? In week one of 2012...
I'm hoping that's the same.
I remember week one of 2012, he went from, like, being owned by 3% of teams in fantasy leagues to, like, 85%. And then by week four, he was back to, like, being, like, 17% owned in Yahoo leagues. I remember because I tried picking him up.
Yeah, he scored like 3 touchdowns there.
Yeah, in that game against the Giants. Ruined
it. I hope this happens, but it's like the opposite for the Jets. They just do bad week one and then just go off for the rest of the season.
That could be, I mean, that could easily also be what happens. I mean, because that's the thing with week one. Crazy shit always happens in week one. I had the Jaguars beating the Packers in week one just because.
Yeah.
And it almost happened. I won't lie, though. I do have the Jaguars winning the AFC South.
Which is, that's possible. That's possible.
It's definitely possible.
That's going to be close. It's definitely going to be close.
AFC South is definitely going to be close, but the Jaguars could pull it out.
It's 2016. It's the year of our Lord, John Idzik.
Idzik.
He's built a nice little team with Jacksonville, though.
Yes. Oh, he did that with us, too.
He did, sort of. I mean, even a broken clock is wrong twice a day. I mean, right, yeah, twice a day.
Yeah. We'll have to see. We'll have to wait and see.
I like McCagnon.
I like McCagnon a lot, too, because he seems to be pretty balanced between the draft and, like, spending in free agency. His hands were really tied this year, and a big part of that is because of that Revis contract. Like, that Revis contract might actually, like, really handcuff us for a couple of seasons. Especially if he's gonna, like, be an old man and shit.
Yo, I don't understand that. I really don't understand how these players sit there and take these fucking contracts that debilitate teams when all you gotta do is invest your money and you make money. Stop being a selfish fuck. Invest your fucking money. Make money off your own fucking money and make your team better. That's it. That's it.
It wouldn't even like be them doing it either. It's like, oh, my accountant handles that.
Yeah, exactly.
No. But they're like, no. You see, this person's making this amount of money, so I want this amount of money.
Yeah, it really is. There's a lot of... It's what I've always said. It's not about, you know, if you're the best at your position.
No.
That determines how much you get paid. It's when you're due for a contract.
Exactly.
What quarterbacks are, like, set to be free agents next year? I don't even know, but...
Sheldon Richards?
You said quarterbacks or corners?
No, I said quarterbacks, QBs.
Oh,
QBs, okay.
QBs are supposed to be free agents next year? Because I bet there's like a fuck ton of mediocre quarterbacks that'll be free agents next year that'll be making more money than Brock Osweiler.
Yeah. And Brock got a good contract, better than what he deserves, truthfully.
That shit, and it was based off of, like, that shit was worse than, like, the Matt Flynn contracts. Because that shit was based off, like...
Matt Flynn, hands down, has the best agent alive.
He does.
Yeah, I'm sorry, yo. Matt Flynn's contract...
He can always find work.
Yeah.
I won't lie. I really wanted the Jets to get him after that one game against the Lions.
Yeah, I want him too. I want him too, but now I'm kind of glad we didn't take him.
Yeah. We had him on our preseason roster last year. But he got cut. So, it might be a little early for this. It might be a bit of an overreaction. Obviously, with Fitz's limitations as arm strength, like, what do you think the odds are we see Bryce Petty at some point this year?
Honestly, I would like to see him, but
I kind of do too.
I did not completely. Seriously, I would like to see him get a start, get a couple starts, but that would mean that
The season's over.
Don't play well.
Yeah, that would mean that the season's over, or that we're like in a big hole. I mean,
I'd rather go to the playoffs, lose in the playoffs, and have Petty learn and come back next season
and be the starter.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think at that point it would probably be Hackenberg versus Petty, but that's probably
I feel like Hackenberg would win, even though Petty would be better.
Just because it would just be like politics would just get in the way because you know they invested more in Hackenberg.
Yeah, exactly. So we have to throw Hackenberg out there.
We really should just draft a quarterback in every draft for every year until one of them ends up being good.
I mean, that's been Jets game for how long now?
Since we drafted Geno? I don't know.
Our first pick next year should definitely be a right tackle.
Right tackle? What are you talking about? We need more defense.
Like a beast right tackle.
Yeah, no, we gotta draft another corner next year to eventually replace Revis.
We definitely needed like a Jalen Ramsey. We need to get like a, I don't know who's good right now.
I really don't know either. Really, the only NFL prospect that I like know about is Deshaun Watson.
Yeah.
What does he play?
Oh,
he's Clemson's quarterback.
Christian McCaffrey, the white running back on Stanford.
Oh.
No. Honestly. If there's one phenomenal cornerback, we're gonna take him.
Honestly, the problem is we'll never have a high enough draft pick to get that one phenomenal quarterback.
Yeah, because the Browns are going to...
No. I said corner.
Corner. Yeah. Corner. Yeah, I would agree, because it's just...
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I completely think our first draft pick of the next season, 2017, is going to be the number one corner.
Revis's heir apparent.
Unless Justin Burris starts lighting it up.
Yeah, I'm calling it right now. I don't even know who it's going to be, but I'm calling it right now. That will be our number one pick. And I'm not going to like it.
So yesterday... Or on Monday, whatever, because I don't even know what day it is anymore. But on Monday, I was listening to like the Coach Bowles report on the Michael K show, and it was honestly the saltiest, like most useless interview I've like ever heard.
From who? Bowles?
Yeah, from Bowles. Like they would ask him questions. They would ask him questions about the game. And he'd be like, yeah, I'm not talking about that. We've moved on to Buffalo. It's like, it was just so pointless. Because I had so many, like, I was really looking forward to this interview. Like, I really had, like, a lot of, there was a lot of shit that I wanted answers for.
Ops and Rex, okay? You have to get Rex out of your mind before you can accept Bowles.
I'm not even saying I want like Rex Ryan answers or Bravado.
No, I understand that, but you gotta understand, like, he's the complete opposite of Rex. He's not gonna be the vocalized coach. Even Herm is a shit ton.
This was actually like that interview yesterday. It was actually like the most emotion. Period. Any type of emotion. It was the most emotion that I've ever seen him show, like in like a public setting. Like that.
I kind of want to watch this tomorrow.
Yeah, I'm sure you can find it online somewhere. Just Google, like, I don't know, Coach Bowles, Michael K. Show.
Yeah, it's probably
on YouTube. Yeah, he just gets so like salty.
Yeah,
And it's like, I kind of like it though, because it kind of gives me, I think the Jets are going to come out into this Buffalo game like real pissed off. And
yeah, I think so.
Jets, Bills, especially between two teams like Jets and Bills, those are always the games where the more pissed off team wins.
And truthfully, it's a very crucial game, and they better get fucking pissed off.
I hope they play this as pissed off.
I hope they play as pissed off as we are. If the Jets played like as pissed off as we were all the time,
we lost to the Bengals.
We would be 16-0.
Do you know what that means? That means like even if we make the playoffs, we're losing. That's what that means, losing the Bengals.
Yeah, because it means we don't get to face the Bengals in the first round, where we would win. Typical Jets.
Yeah, because
that should have been a win. We should have won. We really should have won this fucking game.
I'm pretty sure this first game was the one to determine where we would stand in like the long run.
It was definitely a measuring stick type of game too.
Yeah, exactly. And I'm pretty sure we did measure up. We just fucked up big time.
I mean, yeah, we lost by 1 point. I mean, obviously we'd be in a much better mood if we won, but it would be hard to say like how much better we'd be feeling about the team moving forward if we would have won. I'm sure either way there's positives and negatives to take away from it.
Look at it.
All you can do is
the mistakes that we made, the crucial mistakes that we made
cost us the game.
Exactly. But if we didn't make those mistakes, we would have won by a much higher margin. Where we would look at it like, oh, okay.
We would have. That's also true. We probably would have looked at it as like, oh, like this was like a convincing win.
Yeah.
If they would have.
Like, okay, we came out and we dominated. Because honestly, we should have.
We really should have. Especially if we just changed like a couple of calls. If we would have just
quarter.
Gotten more aggressive, going for it on those fourth downs.
Honestly,
going for touchdowns instead of field goals.
I like him as a coach. I do like him as a coach.
It was coaching. That was
but I blame Ross on Bowles.
I blame it on him more than anybody else. Because people are saying Folk or Brandon Marshall for dropping that pass and, you know, having Revis, but really. I mean, from top to bottom, everyone has a part in it.
There were plenty of mistakes, but
really,
when it came down to it,
it starts with coaching.
Yeah, exactly. And the coach has to respect that.
I'm sure.
I know Rex owned every loss that he had.
I respected the shit out of that. Anytime they lost a game, he would say, "This is on me."
Yes, exactly. I loved that about Rex. I absolutely loved it about Rex.
Even though he could have, because in 2014 he could have easily said, "Yeah, you know, this is what happens when you play $40 million on the salary cap."
He could have shot Sanchez up with steroids and still taken a loss and blamed it on himself.
Yep. I wouldn't be surprised if he has.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Yeah, so the way I kind of see it going with the Jets is I see it getting sloppier before it gets cleaner. Like, I think they're going to play sloppier in this game, and then I think that...
But that's the thing. Our sloppy season was last season. Last season was our sloppy season. Because next season, we're going to have basically a rookie quarterback.
I'm not... I mean, I get what you're saying,
not,
but...
Not rookie-wise, not rookie...
Well, here's what I'm saying. here's what I'm saying. I'm saying I think this week we're gonna play a sloppier game than we played in week one, and then I think after that is when they're gonna start cleaning shit up.
But we can't afford that.
We can't afford that. But what I'm saying,
if this game wasn't a division game, yes, maybe we could afford it. But
I'm not saying
it's probably gonna be a sloppy
game. I'm not saying we're gonna lose. Yeah, I'm saying it's going to be a real ugly, sloppy win. Like, I'm not saying we're going to lose. It's going to be a real ugly, sloppy win.
Rex, that has enough. I'm sorry. Rex, that has enough. But we can't afford to lose this game. We cannot afford to lose this game. Because even if we win this game, Rex is still going to come back with a vendetta to beat us next time. So we have to shit on him this game.
Either way, he's coming back with a vendetta.
I feel like that vendetta
can only take him so far. I mean, I feel like the Jets know. I feel
Rex?
Like the,
it's Rex. Rex. Re, 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 Rex is gonna take that vendetta to his grave.
But see,
that's how Rex
even
is.
Even when Rex had a vendetta when he was coaching with us, he'd still lose games.
Exactly.
He would. But.
The Jets could have easily won both of the Bills games last year.
Against the Patriots.
He still got blown out in a lot of those games.
He did, but...
He won a few of them, too.
Certain of those plays... Alright, we don't have Tom Brady as a quarterback. Certain of those plays... A lot of the fifth plays... A lot of the games... It was like, okay, you know, this could have been close if this didn't happen. Like... Certain plays didn't happen is possible. We're not the team that is going to pull out off those plays. We're not the team that's going to be like, okay, all right, we have this phenomenal quarterback who's going to fantastic pass. That was the issue that Rex faced. Rex doesn't have to face that issue against us. That's my issue with him.
That's a good point. I still think that we could have easily won both of those games, and I think the Jets know certain things that they could clean up, because honestly, also I know, and this is kind of a tribute to like how good the Ryan brothers are as defensive minds, but. I could barely even name a starter on the Bills defense. Like, I don't think any of those players are really even that good, aside from, like, Marcell Dareus.
That's the sad part.
Like, really, they're not that... Personnel-wise, they're not that good, but Rex and Rob can coach them up. But
formation-wise, they are.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. They can coach them up. They can put them in the right places... Exactly. In the right roles where they know how to succeed.
And also, their first round pick is out.
Yeah. Look, alright, I don't care what anyone says. I will always fear a Rex defense.
Oh, I will too. I mean, even some of the.
You should fear ours.
I mean, dude.
If you can rise up to that, honestly, our defense played better under Rex than they were playing under Bowles.
I feel like
they're a lot less suspect under Rex. The Bowles defenses are a lot more opportunistic than Rex's defenses, but the Jets defense isn't what everyone says that defense is until they prove it on the field. You know, everyone's saying the Jets have this elite defense, but they have to make a stop in a big spot in a game, which is something they haven't done in a very long time. I think it starts with this Thursday.
Seriously. I feel like if we can dominate the Bills, our morale...
It would skyrocket. This is such, like...
Yeah.
It's such an important game. It really is. It really is. Like...
Just to us. Forget the league. Just our players. This is such a crucial game.
It really is. Because if we come out of this game with a win, then it's like, all right, we finally got the monkey off our back. We finally beat the Bills. Then you have a long week to prepare for the Chiefs, who,
yeah,
I still don't fucking know how I feel about the Chiefs.
It's Alex Smith. It's Alex Smith. Okay, you can stop Alex Smith with the right defense coordinations.
They have like two receivers.
You can, but honestly, Andy Reid, the fact that the Chiefs managed to do what they do, it just attributes to how good of a coach Andy Reid is.
I would give Smith more credit than Reid.
I don't think I could agree with that because the Chiefs are just not really, because the Chiefs are just such like a well-rounded team.
They are. I completely agree with you, but Smith,
he's mastered the art of being a game managing quarterback.
And we are also getting the opportunity to dominate their defense without Justin Houston.
That's true.
Yeah.
It's very true. Very true.
So we're getting another free pass on a good player on an opposing defense.
Let's see if we can
capitalize.
Let's see if we can do something about it.
Well, let's focus on this Bills game first. Let's get that win.
Yeah. Yeah, seriously. That's
the thing. The Bills game is going to be either demoralizing or absolutely phenomenal to our morale.
It really is that. You know what it reminds me of? Not to go back to the last time we started 0-1, but it kind of reminds me of that week in 2010, that week 2 game against the Patriots where they won, where the Jets won. Because it was that kind of game where, it was just that kind of game where if the Jets would have lost that game and started out 0-2 the year they were on Hard Knocks, the year they were talking all the shit about winning the Super Bowl,
especially, we went nowhere at all.
Yeah, our season would have been over after that. But because they won, they were able to really rally around it. And I feel like it's the same. I feel like it's the same deal this game. You know,
the thing is, only difference is the fact that our offense will rally more than our defense will. Because back then, we were honestly pure defensive.
Yeah.
We were pure defensive. Right now, we're trying to be more so, not purely, but more so.
But more of a balanced team.
Right. Yeah. But I want to say more offensive just because we signed Fitz again, okay? So he has to step shit up.
Right.
He really does. He has to
step shit up.
Looking back, like I really can't name a game where we saw Fitz like do really well.
Yeah, he really never put up like staggering numbers. I mean,
he's not a Hall of Famer.
He's a mediocre at best quarterback, but for whatever reason, there's something inspiring about him.
He can win a championship.
He could.
With this team,
there have been teams with like mediocre quarterbacks that have.
He can lead a team. He can really fucking lead a team. We get behind him.
Yeah, like
our team gets behind him.
Do you remember how happy like the day Fitz signed and was back in training camp? Do you remember how happy everyone was? Like the team was just so stoked about it. He needs to play. He needs to play like marginally better. That's really it.
Right.
If he plays marginally better, cut out like a couple of mistakes, maybe throw the ball further than 10 yards once in a while. Like, and then we'll really be in business.
You know what's a sad comparison that I compare him to?
Smith. To Alex Smith?
Yeah.
Yeah. He's like Alex Smith, except he's like kind of. He's a little funkier.
He really should be better. With I mean, arts. Smith has weapons, yeah, but
with what he we have so much better. I mean, because Smith has Macklin, but after aside from Macklin and Charles, like that receiving core is pretty thin. The Chiefs,
yeah. I mean, Smith will do more work with his core.
I mean, it wasn't. I mean, let's not forget, it was only 2 years ago that the Chiefs didn't have a receiving. They didn't have a touchdown catch by a wide receiver. I forget if it was at all. I forget if it was at all, or if like Dwayne Bowe caught a pass in like a touchdown in like week 17.
But that's even so, Smith still.
He's still.
Losing quarterback.
He's more consistent than Fitz, and I think that's the problem.
Like, honestly, I would take Smith, but Fitz's arm is better in my opinion.
I don't even know if I would like say that though, because I mean,
you think his arm's worse?
It's hard to say. Maybe the same. I mean, maybe I feel like Alex Smith might be more accurate than Fitz. Fitz might be able to throw it a little bit.
Smith is definitely more accurate. Smith, in my opinion,
more
accurate.
Fitz might be able to throw it a little bit further than Alex, but I feel like
more accuracy and more power.
I would take, and Fitz really struggled with like high velocity throws too, like.
Yeah, especially with Marshall. Marshall's type receiver where you need it.
You gotta feed him. You gotta feed him.
Yes, you have to.
Because he got what? He
and Decker too. Decker's ready for the on the run. I'm gonna catch it for you. Don't worry about it. And I'm gonna try to create.
You don't have to feed Decker as much. Decker's more of like a. Decker's kind of more of like a decoy. Like, hey, if they're double covering Marshall, like. Yo, find me, and I got you. Like, he's a lot more, like, he's kind of just more, like, a reliable guy. But Marshall's just someone you have to feed, because that gets the whole team going, too. Like, Marshall, like,
really, really...
Like, his energy.
Third receiver.
That's when shit starts to get going, because once you feed Marshall... Everyone sees like how good he does, and it boosts everyone else to do good too.
Exactly, and Dexter's a type that is gonna strive to beat you.
Yeah,
Dexter's a type like no. I want to be a number receiver, and I love that about Decker. Decker does want to be a number receiver. He's not a number receiver, but
I cannot complain about Decker. It's not one bit.
Hell no, you can't. Yes, because he works so. Yeah.
Everything. And you remember how last week we were talking about what our weak points would be? And one of them was the offensive line. I thought the offensive line did look really good, actually.
They really did. I mean, did Fitz get sacked once in that game?
I think, like, just barely.
I don't.
Did he get sacked? I don't think
He was under. He was under a lot of duress, but he.
He was
under duress, but he got out of it.
But
yeah,
usually get out like make a run.
Yeah, there really weren't. I mean, there might have been like one or two sacks. Yeah, yeah. But
what if Petty? What if Petty could be a Russell Wilson?
Why not?
No, I'm sorry, y'all. All right,
I haven't seen enough of him.
I'm sorry.
I do want to see what Petty could do with the first team. I like Petty a lot too.
Wilson. I mean, the Jets could be a fucking hands down contender for a Super Bowl if he's a Russell Wilson.
I think he should have proved that to us already.
He had his chances, but he really didn't. He really hasn't had a chance because. He hasn't played with the first team yet. You haven't seen him play with the first team, so you know until Petty plays with the first team, you really don't know. So it's hard to say like he should have proved that because he's never had a chance.
I really hope he's our next quarterback. I really do.
I do too.
I really fucking do.
I honestly could imagine a scenario. Maybe it's probably a pipe dream, but. I can imagine a scenario where, you know, all right, so there's all this hype around getting Fitz back. Like, all right, we got our guy back. And then he underperforms. And then, you know, say week six rolls around. Then, you know, were like 2-4 and they benched kind of like what kind of like what happened when the Jets benched Testaverde for Pennington, where Petty comes in and like the team, you know, rallies around him and the offense gets a lot more vertical and he becomes the guy. I could see it happening.
Pennington was the guy because his accuracy.
It's his accuracy. Also, he's got the arm strength too. He can.
Well, all right. Arm strength for like any throw under 40 yards.
Yeah, I was gonna say I don't remember him throwing.
Okay, maybe he doesn't throw like 65 yard bombs, but I mean, still, that's still an upgrade in arm strength from what we have now with Fitz.
But that's because Vinny was getting old. But still, Vinny wasn't as accurate as Pennington was.
I mean, okay, maybe that was like, it was probably a bad comparison in terms of arm strength. But I mean, you get what I mean, though, right?
Like, yeah, no. I completely understand what you mean. That's what I'm saying. Petty, if he had, honestly, give him a chance to the first team. See what he does.
If it's that bad,
I think shit would have to really hit the fan for that to happen.
Definitely, yeah. Oh, yeah. Because we're getting stuck on Fitz. Fitz only has one more year. I swear to God, if we give Fitz another year, I might be done being Jets fan. I might not be able to take that.
The only way that'll happen is if we win a Super Bowl.
Yeah, yeah.
Even then, they should probably just be like, "Listen, man, like, thank you, but we got our Super Bowl, and it's time to move on."
I'd say forget time to move on. I'd say, yo, I'm gonna trade you for a good fucking another good wide receiver.
Honestly, if the Jets win a Super Bowl, I don't give a fuck what they do after. If the Jets win a Super Bowl, I will stop watching football. Maybe I'll watch the opening game. I'll watch the opening game next season when they raise the banner, and after that, I'm done. I'm done dedicating my life to this shit. It's the only reason I watch football is to hope that one day they do it.
We might have to retire being Jets fans because, like, I think, like, I've gotten so much stress from this bullshit.
Yeah.
I don't know. I've grown a lot of gray hairs.
The Jets definitely contribute to it. If I were to break down like attributions of like the gray hair I have and like, you know, break it down to percentage, I'd say like 25% of that is probably the Jets. 25% of it is probably sleep deprivation. Another 25% was probably like from stressing myself out at school, which also contributes to sleep deprivation, and then like the other, and then like the which other 20, and then the other 25% is just from like not getting laid enough. But speaking of retiring, I think it's time to end this podcast because we've been doing this for like 2 hours. But so final predictions for Thursday.
Final predictions. Yeah, I'm gonna stick with my 20-14.
20-14.
Yeah.
I'm gonna stick with 17-16.
22-17. Shit on them.
Yeah. How's that for that omen shit? I wanted to say 22-17 too, but I just feel like it's gonna be like way
like really here. That happened twice. Come on.
Yeah. All right. Well, on that note, that's it. If anyone has any final things they'd like to say. Now would be
I love the swag.
It's a bullshit out.